My mother makes spaghetti with ketchup. What chance do I have?
I'm almost through. All right, darling, don't get up too quickly.
You have better color today, sweetheart. Did you get a little sun this morning?
I walked down the beach. Very slowly, I hope.
Yes, that's good.
She gets all this special treatment because the doctor says she has some sort of flutter in her heart. I got hit right in the back of the skull with the baseball and saw two of everything for a week, and I still had to carry a block of ice home every afternoon. Girls are treated like queens. Maybe that's what I should have been born. An Italian girl.
Eugene.
What?
How many times have I told you not to leave your things around the house?
109.
What?
Except for yesterday. I told you 109 times not to leave your things around the house.
Don't be fresh to your mother, Jean.
Was I fresh? I swear to God, that's what she said to me yesterday. You know, one day I'm gonna put this all into a book or a play. I'm gonna be a writer like a Ring Lager or somebody. That's if things don't work out first with the Yankees. Or the Cubs. Or the Red Sox. Or maybe possibly the Tigers. If I get down to St. Louis Browns, I'll definitely be a writer.
Mom, can I have a glass of lemonade?
It'll spoil your dinner, darling.
A small glass, it couldn't hurt.
All right. In a minute, Angel.
I'll get it. I'm in the kitchen anyway.
Can you believe that? She better have a bad heart or I'm gonna kill her one of these days. Listen, I hope you don't repeat any of this to anybody. What I'm telling you are my secret memoirs. It's called The Unbelievable, Fantastic, and Completely Private Thoughts of I, Eugene Morris Jerome. In this, the 15th year of his life, in the year 1937, in the community of Brighton Beach, Borough of Brooklyn, Kings County, City of New York, Empire State of the American Nation.
A roll escape on my kitchen floor. Do you want me, Dennis, that what you want?
I didn't leave it there.
No? Then who? Aunt Blanche, Laurie, did you ever see them on skates? Take this upstairs. Come here.
Hey, go to my school, I have a concussion.
What would you tell your father if he came home from work and found me dead on the kitchen floor, huh?
I'd say, don't go in the kitchen, Pa.
Don't come down with dirty hands.
You see why I want to write all this down? In case I grow up all twisted and warped, the world will know why.
He's a boy. He's young. You should be glad he's healthy and active. Before the doctors found out what Laurie had, she was the same way.
Never. Girls are different. When you and I were girls, we kept the house spotless. It was Ben and Ezra who drove Mama crazy. I've always been like that. I have to have things clean, just like Mama. The day they left and packed up the house in Russia, she cleaned the place from top to bottom. She said, no matter what the Cossacks did to us, she would have respect for the Jews.
Who are the Cossacks?
The same filthy bunches live across the street.
Across the street? You mean the Murphys?
All of them.
The Murphys are Russian.
The mother's nice. She's been very sweet to me.
Her windows are so filthy, I thought she had black curtains hanging inside.
I was in the house. It was very neat. Nobody can be as clean as you.
What business did you have in their house?
She invited me for tea.
To meet that drunken son of hers?
No, just the two of us.
I'm living here 7 years. She never invited me for tea. Because she knows your situation. I know that kind. Remember what Mama used to tell us? Stay on your own side of the street. That's what they have got us for.
That's what they have got us for. If my mother knew I was writing all this down, she'd stuff me like one of her chickens.
I'd better explain what she meant by Aunt Blanche's situation. You see, her husband, Uncle Dave, died 6 years ago from this thing. They never say the word. They always whisper it. It was cancer. I think they're afraid that if they said it out loud, God would say, I heard that! You said the dread disease, and just for that I smite you down with it! There's some things that grown-ups just won't discuss. For example, my grandfather, he died from diphtheria. Anyway, so after Uncle Dave died, he left Aunt Blanche with no money.
Not even insurance,
and she couldn't support herself because she has asthma.
So, my kind-hearted mother insisted that she and the two kids come in to live with us.
So they broke our room up into two smaller rooms. And me and my brother Stan live on this side, and Laurie and her sister Nora live on the other side. My father thought it would only be temporary,
but it's been 3.5 years so far, and I think because of Aunt Blanche's situation, my father's developing high blood pressure.
Have some more lemonade.
Thank you, Auntie. Drink it slowly.
I will.
Blanche, that's enough already since 7 o'clock this morning.
I was just stopping.
You'll sew your fingers together.
It's getting dark anyway. I think I need new glasses.
Our teacher said she may change them every 2 years.
And would it kill you to put a light on?
I don't have to run up electric bills. I owe you and Jack enough as it is.
Have I asked you for anything? You see anyone starving around here? If I go hungry, you'll give me something from your plate.
Kate, I'm gonna pay you a Jack back someday. I don't know when, but I keep my word.
From your lips to the Irish sweepstakes. Go in and taste the soup, see if it needs salt.
Should I put out the water glasses, or is Eugene going to use
it? Eugene, I'm not gonna tell you again! Just do the napkins, darling.
Because of her condition, I have to go twice as much work around here.
If I could just make the Yankees,
I'd be in St. Petersburg this winter.
Now, her sister Nora isn't too bad. She's 16. I don't mind her much. At least she's not too bad to look at. To be absolutely honest, this is the year I started noticing girls that weren't too bad to look at. Nora started developing about 8 months ago. I have the exact date written down in my diary.
Mom, Lori, Aunt Kate, I have incredible news, everybody.
Hi, Nora.
Eugene, my sweet, adorable, handsome cousin. Wait till I tell you what's happened to me.
I felt her chest. When she grabbed me, I felt my first chest.
Oh, I can't believe this whole day.
What happened?
Where's Mom? Aunt Kate, I have to tell everyone.
What's all the excitement?
You're all red in the face.
Sit down, Mom. I don't want you fainting them before.
Sit down, Blanche.
Mom, sit down.
You two are okay. Okay. Is everybody ready?
Stop dragging it out. The suspense is killing me.
Don't say things like that, Lori.
Can I hear what the girl has to say?
Go ahead, darling.
Okay. Here it goes. I'm gonna be in a Broadway show. It's a musical called Abracadabra. This man, Mr. Beckman, he's a producer, came to our dancing class this afternoon and he picked up three girls. We have to be at the Hudson Theater on Monday morning at 10 o'clock to audition for the dance director. Oh, but on the way out, he took me aside and said the job was as good as mine. Oh, I have to call him tomorrow. Oh, I may have to go into town to talk to him about it. Oh, they start rehearsing a week from Monday. And then it goes to Philadelphia, Wilmington, Washington, and then it comes to New York the second week in December. There are 9 big musical numbers. And there's a big tank on the stage that you can see through. Oh, and the big finale all takes place with the entire cast underwater. I mean, can you believe it? I'm gonna be in a Broadway show, Mama.
What is she talking about?
Do I know? Am I her mother?
How can you be in a Broadway show? Don't you have to sing and act?
I can sing.
No, you can't.
A little.
No, you can't.
I can carry the tune.
No, you can't.
Well, I probably won't have to. They're just looking for dancers.
On Broadway, you have to sing and act.
How do you know? You've never seen a Broadway show.
Did you tell him how old you were?
He didn't ask me.
He didn't ask if you were 16?
He just asked me to audition. My God, isn't anybody excited?
I am. I'm excited. This is the most fantastic news I've ever heard.
Thanks, Eugene. I'm glad somebody's excited.
My God, I'm going to be sleeping right next door to a showgirl.
How can you go to Philadelphia? What about school?
School? Mama, this is a Broadway show. This is what I want to do with my life. Algebra and English isn't going to help me on the stage.
Aren't.
Will you stay out of this?
You mean not finish school? You mean not get a diploma? Do you know how hard it is for a girl to get a decent job without a high school diploma?
I've got a job, and I'll be making more money than 10 girls with diplomas.
You don't have it yet. You still have to audition.
It's as good as nothing. Mr. Beckman told me.
And what if you, God forbid, broke a leg or got heavy? How long do you think they'll keep you?
Dancing is just a few years. A diploma is forever. I know. I never got one. I know how hard it is to find a decent job. And Kate knows. Tell her, Kate.
It's very hard.
And why did you send me to dance school for 3 years? Why do I spend 2 hours a day on the subway, 4 days a week after school, with money you make going half blind over a broken sewing machine? Why, Mama?
Because it's my pleasure. Because I know how you love it. Because you asked me.
And I'm asking you something else, Mama. Let me do something for you now. I've been making almost $60 a week, maybe even more. In 2 years, when I get out of high school, I wouldn't make that much with a college diploma.
I can't think now. It's almost dinner time. Your Uncle Jack will be home soon. We'll discuss it later.
But I have to know now, Mama. I have to call Mr. Beckman and let him know if I can go on Monday. Please let me audition. Let me find out first if they think I'm good enough. Please don't say no until Monday.
It was a tense moment for everybody. I love tense moments, especially when I'm not the one they're all tense about.
Well, God knows we could use the money. We all owe Aunt Kate and Uncle Jack enough as it is. I think they have as much say in this as I do. What do you think about it, Kate?
Me? I never voted before in my life. Why start with my own family? Bye, Dave.
And we'll leave it up to your Uncle Jack. We'll let him make the decision.
Why, Mama? I love him, but he's not my father.
Because I need help. Because I don't always know what the right thing to do is. Because I said so, that's why.
Eugene M. Jerome of New York has one vote for yes!
Listen. What I'm about to tell you is so incredibly secret that I've left instructions for my memoirs not to be opened until 30 years after my death. I, Eugene M. Jerome, have committed a mortal sin by lusting after my cousin Nora. I can tell you all this now because I'll be dead by the time you're reading it. If I had my choice between a tryout with the Yankees
and actually seeing her bare breast for 2.5 seconds, I would have some serious thinking to do.
I need bread.
What?
I don't have enough bread. Run across the street to Green Flats and get me a fresh rye bread.
Again?
I went to the store this morning.
And so you'll go again this afternoon.
I'm always going to the store. When I go up, that's all I'll be trained to do. Go to the store.
You don't want
to
go? Never mind, I'll go.
Don't do that. Don't make me feel guilty. I'll go.
And get a quarter pound of butter.
I bought a quarter pound of butter this morning.
Why don't you buy a half pound at a time?
And suppose the house burned down this afternoon. Why do I need an extra quarter pound of butter?
If my mother taught logic in high school, this would be some weird country.
So, what are you gonna do?
I don't know. Leave me alone. Don't just sit there watching me.
It's mine as much as yours. I don't have to leave. I don't want to.
Do you have to stare at me? Can't I have any privacy?
I'm staring into space. I can't help it if your body interferes.
I bet you were. How would you feel if your entire life depended on what your Uncle Jack decided? Oh God, I wish Daddy were alive.
He would have said no. He looked really strict.
Not with me. I mean, he was strict, but he was fair. If he said no, he always gave you a good reason. He always talked things out. I wish I could call Summer now and ask him what to do. One permitted call to heaven is all.
Talks to him every night.
Who told you that?
She did. Every night before she goes to bed, she puts his picture on her pillow and talks to him. Then she pulls the blanket halfway up and goes to sleep.
He does not.
She does too. Last year, when I had a big fever, I slept in bed with both of them. In the middle of the night, his picture fell and cut my nose.
She never told me that. That's weird.
I can't remember him much. No, I used to remember him real good.
Oh God, he's so handsome. Always dressed so dapper. His shoes.
The snow is coming down in a near blizzard. He gets it. He fades back. He passes. And Luckman's got it. He's on the 50, the 40, the 30, the 20. It's a touchdown! Columbia wins! They defeat the mighty Crimson of Harvard 13-12. Listen to the crowd roar!
Yo, James, stop that yelling! I have a cake in the oven!
Hey, Yuji.
Hi, Stan. My brother Stan, you'll like him. He's okay. What you doing home so early?
Pop home yet?
No. Did you get the tickets?
What tickets?
To the Yankee game. Said you know a guy who could get us passes. You didn't ask him?
No, me and my boss had other things to talk about. I'm in trouble, Huge. I mean real, real trouble.
That really surprised me, because Stan's the kind of guy who could talk himself out of any kind of trouble. What kind of trouble?
I got fired today.
Fired? You mean for good?
Well, you don't get fired temporarily. It's a permanent thing. It's a lifetime firing.
Why? What happened?
Well, it's on account of Andrew, the colored guy who sweeps up. Well, he's cleaning the floor in the stockroom. When he puts the broom down on the table, to put some junk in the trash can, the broom slips, knocks a can of linseed oil over the table, ruins 3 brand new hats right out of the box. $9 Stetsons. It wasn't his fault. He didn't put the linseed oil there, right?
Right.
So anyway, Mr. Stroheim sees these oily hats and he gets crazy. He says to Andrew that these hats are gonna have to come out of his salary. $27. So Andrew starts to cry.
He cried?
42 years old, he's bawling all over the stock room. Man hasn't got too much furniture upstairs anyway, but he's real sweet. Always brings me a coffee in the morning, always laughing, telling me jokes. I never understand them, but I laugh anyways. Make him feel good, you know?
Yeah.
So anyways, I says to Mrs. Strom, I didn't think that was fair. It wasn't Andrew's fault.
You said that to him?
Sure, why not? So he says to me, you want to pay for that, big mouth? And I say, no, I don't want to pay for the hat. So he says, then mind your own business, big mouth.
Holy mackerel.
So Mrs. Strawn's looking at me like machine gun bullets are coming out of his eyes. Then he calmly sends Andrew over to the stockroom to pick up 3 new hats, which is usually my job. So guess what he tells me to do?
What?
He tells me to sweep up. He says, for this week, I'm the cleaning man.
I can't believe it.
You could see everybody in the store was looking at me, waiting to see what I'm gonna do. Even Andrew stopped crying and watched. I felt the dignity of everyone in that stockroom was in my hands. So I grit my teeth, I pick up the broom, and there's this big pile of dirt right in the middle of the floor.
Yeah?
And I sweep it all over Mr. Stroheim's shoes. Andrew just finished polishing them this morning, if you want to talk about irony.
I'm dying. I'm actually dying.
You could see everybody in the place was about to bust a gut. Mrs. Mulcahy, the bookkeeper, can hardly keep a false teeth in her mouth. And whose eyes are hanging 5 inches out of their sockets.
This is the greatest story in the history of the world.
As Mr. Strawham grabbed me and pulled me into his back office, closed the door, pulled down the blinds, gives me this whole talk about how he was brought up in Germany to respect his superiors, and that if he ever did such a thing like you do, they would beat me in the head until they carried me away dead.
That's perfect! You got him down perfect!
And I say, yeah, but we're not in Germany, old buddy.
You said that to him?
No, I said it to myself. I didn't want to go too far.
I was wondering.
So anyways, Mr. Strom says to me that he's always thought I was a good boy. And he's always liked me. So he's gonna give me one more chance. He wants a letter of apology. If that letter of apology isn't on his desk by 9 o'clock tomorrow morning, I can consider myself fired.
I would have had a heart attack.
What did you say?
I said I wasn't gonna apologize if Andrew still had to pay for the hats. He said that was between him and Andrew, and that he expected the letter in the morning. So I said goodnight. I picked up my hat, I walked out of his office, and I went home 10 minutes early.
I'm sweating. I swear to God, I am sweating all over.
I don't know why I did it. I just got so mad, it wasn't fair. I mean, if you give up when you're 18 and a half, you'll give up for the rest of your life, don't you think?
I suppose so. So what are you gonna do? Are you gonna write a letter?
No.
Positively?
Positively. They'll have to check with Pop first. I know we need the money. But he once said to me, you always have to do what you think is right in this world. You have to stand up for your principles.
And what if he thinks you're wrong, that you should write the letter?
He won't. He'll let me decide, I know it.
But what if he says, write the letter?
That's something that we won't know until after dinner, now will we?
All in all, it was shaping up to be one heck of a dinner.
I'll say this though. I always had this two-way thing about my brother Stan. Either I worshipped the ground he walked on, or I hated him so much I wanted to kill him. I guess you know how I feel about him today.
All day it takes to bring home bread. Give Aunt Blanche the butter. She's been waiting.
I was home a half hour ago. I was talking to Stan.
I got a letter from Roslyn Weiner. Remember her? They live up on Central Park West. They moved to Manhattan.
Why not? Father's a gangster. Her mother's worse. I don't get a kiss. Hello?
Oh, no, I was going to save it up and give you a giant one for Christmas.
We don't have Christmas. I'll take it now, thank you. A hug, too? When do I ever get a hug from you? You must have done something wrong.
You're too smart for me, Mom. I robbed the barbershop today.
Is that why you look so tired? You don't get enough sleep running around all night with your 200 girlfriends?
130, that's all I have, 130.
How do you get any work done?
I get it done.
And your boss doesn't say anything to you about being tired?
About being tired? No, he doesn't.
Did you ask him about Thursday?
What?
You were gonna ask him about getting paid this Thursday so I can pay Greenblatt on Friday? Saturday's a holiday.
Oh, what the god, I'll ask him tomorrow.
If it's a problem, don't ask him. Greenblatt can wait. Your boss is more important.
Hey, that's not true, Mom. My boss isn't any more important than Mr. Greenblatt.
Oh no. Oh no! As if things weren't bad enough. And now this? The ultimate tragedy. Liver and cabbage for dinner!
True wish medieval torture. My friend, Monty Gregorio, a nice student in science, told me the cooked cabbage can be smelled further than sound traveling for 7 minutes.
If I never finish my memoirs, you'll know it's because I gagged to death one night in the middle of supper. You're all my witnesses! I was sitting here, right? Now watch, I'll get blamed for it anyway.
Eugene said you were holding your chest.
I wasn't holding my chest.
You have to carry that box every day back and forth into the city. You don't work hard enough, Jack.
If you want the box, it's yours. Keep it. I don't need it anymore.
What do you mean?
Delmar's party favors went out of business. They closed them out. The man is bankrupt.
Oh, my God!
He just warned me it was coming.
I thought he lived up on Riverside Drive with the view of the river. A $200 a month apartment, he had a man like that.
Who are the ones you think go bankrupt? You live in a cold water flat on Delancey Street. Bankruptcy is one thing God spares you.
All right. You can always find good in something. You don't have to lock that box anymore. You don't have to get up at 5:30 in the morning. We can all eat dinner at a decent hour, and you still have your job at Jacobson's. We won't starve.
I can't get by with what I make at Jacobson's, not with seven people to feed.
They'll hear you. We'll talk later.
I can't make ends meet with what I make at Jacobson's. I can't pay food and rent and insurance and clothing for seven people. Christmas and New Year's alone, I made $150.
Stop it, Jack. You'll only get yourself sick.
He didn't even pay me for the week. The bastard. Five salesmen are laid off, and he's going to a Broadway show tonight. I stuffed every hat and noisemaker I could carry in that box and walked out of there. At his funeral, I'll put in a pointy hat and I'll blow a horn. You bastard.
Don't talk like that. Something will come up. You'll go to temple this weekend. You'll pray all day Saturday.
There's men in that temple who have been praying for 40 years. You know how many prayers have to get answered before my turn comes up?
Your turn will come up. God has time for everybody.
Here's your water, Aunt Blanche.
Thank you, darling.
Where's Nora?
She went out to call Stanley for dinner.
Hey, Laura, you want to go for a walk on the beach tonight?
I have homework. Why do you want to walk on the beach with me for?
Oh, you know, you, me, and Nora. I just wanted to go for a walk, that's all.
I think she has a date with Larry Clarman.
Larry Clarman? She likes Larry Clarman?
I don't know. Ask her yourself.
Larry Clarman's my father's age.
He's 20.
Same thing. You think he's good looking?
I don't think anyone's good looking.
Larry Clarman. The man doesn't even have a chin. His tie comes all the way up to his teeth.
Eugene, where's the father's water?
I'm coming. Now I've got Larry Clarman to contend with. Here's your water, Pop. I put ice in it.
Don't drink so fast.
Do you have time to look at my sneakers, Pop?
What does he want to look at your sneakers for?
They have no soles. They're hanging on by a tiny piece of rubber. I have to clench my toes when I go to catch a fly ball.
I bought your new sneakers last month.
Last year, Pop. Not last month. I can only wear them for 2 hours a day because my toes won't grow in them.
This is no time to talk to your father about sneakers. He's got enough on his mind. Turn the light down on the window. We'll talk about this tonight. You'll eat a nice dinner. Relax, and when everybody's asleep, we'll talk about this quietly. I don't like it when you get upset. All right, I feel better. Come help me in the kitchen, Laurie.
You think she'll ever get married?
Blanche?
She's not unattractive, but see my look at her on the beach. What does she want to waste her life in this house for?
She's raising two children.
Why doesn't she ever go out? If she wants to meet people, I know plenty of single men.
Blanche isn't the type to get married.
She was married once, wasn't she? Those are the type that get married.
Dave was different. She isn't interested in other men.
What about that Murphy fella across the street? He's plenty interested, believe me.
That drunk? The man can't find his way into the house tonight. I found him lying in the doorway once. In the rain, he was there when I went out to get the milk.
He's got a good paying job, lives alone with his mother. So he takes a drink on a Saturday night. Maybe what he needs is a good woman.
Not my sister. Let him meet someone lying in the next doorway. I don't want to be something.
Come in.
Are you busy? I wanted to talk to you.
Well, that's funny, because I wanted to talk to you.
About what?
I need a favor real bad. You're the only one who can help me. When Pop comes home tired, he doesn't pay too much attention to me like Eugene. He's different with you. He's always interested in what you have to say.
Really? Well, I hope so.
sure. You never noticed that?
Not really, no. What's the favor?
Okay, this may sound dumb, but I don't know if you think you could steer the conversation in a certain direction.
What direction?
Something like, how much you admire people who stand up for their principles?
What people?
Well, any people. Principles is the important word there. If you could work it in 3 or 4 times, I would be very grateful.
3 or 4 times?
It'll be easy. I'll mention someone like, Abraham Lincoln, and you'll be like, now there's a man who really stood up for his principles.
I have my own things to bring up at dinner. I don't want to get into a discussion about Abraham Lincoln.
Not his whole life, just his principles.
Why would I do such a stupid thing?
Because as of tomorrow, I'm unemployed. Unless someone besides me mentions sticking up for their principles.
What happened? Is she a fire?
I will be unless I write Kaiser Wilhelm a letter of apology. I've decided to do what my dad says. I decided to ask him.
When are you going to ask him?
Tonight, right after dinner.
Tonight? Does it have to be tonight?
Well, that's the deadline. I have to get my letter to Mr. Storm in the morning.
Couldn't you ask your father in the morning?
He gets up at 5:30. My mom has to set out his shoes at night because he can't make decisions at 5:30. What's wrong, Nora?
I don't know what you have to complain about. At least your father is alive and around the house to make decisions. You don't know when you're well off, Stanley. Sometimes you make me sick.
And I got to see halfway up those thighs that led to the golden palace of the Himalayas.
You dare! Take it out, you on your lap, and stop daydreaming.
Stanley knew what I was doing, because he's the one who taught it to me. But he was busy with his own problems like everyone else. You could hear the clock ticking in the kitchen. The tension in the air was so thick, you could cut it with a knife, which is more than I could say for the liver. I'm thrilled up with the side.
You sit there and you finish your liver.
I'm finished. You see me liver on my plate?
I know your tricks. You buried it under the mashed potato. Look how Laurie comes.
I had a serious problem. One more bite and I would have thrown up all over the table. A sight Nora would have remembered forever. A diversion was my only escape from humiliation.
So how's things down in Stroheim?
I felt bad about that one. But at least for the moment, attention had shifted away from my liver.
How long have you been working there now?
Where?
At Stroheim's.
Stroheim's, let me see. Part-time a year and a half before I graduated high school, and a year since then.
So what's that?
1.5 years, counting part-time.
And he likes you?
Who?
Mr. Stroheim.
Mr. Stroheim, yeah. He usually likes me. Sometimes I'm not sure.
You come in on time?
Yeah.
You do your work?
Yeah.
You get along with other people?
Yeah.
So why shouldn't he like you? How much are you making there now?
$17 a week.
It's time you moved up. Tomorrow you go in and ask him for a raise.
A raise?
You don't speak up, people take advantage. Tomorrow morning you go into his office, you're polite, you're respectful, but you're firm. You tell him you think you're worth another $5 a week.
$5?
I'll offer you $1.25, you settle for $2.50. I know how these things work. You're a high school graduate, he's lucky he's got you.
I don't think this is the time to ask Mr. Strawn for a raise, Pop. I think his wife is very sick.
You're afraid to ask him. Want me to take you by the hand, walk into his office, and say my little boy wants a raise?
I'm not afraid.
You believe me, Stanley, now is the time to ask for it. If your father didn't think so, he wouldn't ask him.
I think I have a bone in my throat.
There are no bones in liver!
So it's to a dancing school. Nora, you definitely use me.
Mind your own business.
I'm just trying to juice the subject.
I don't need your help. Mother, will you tell her to be quiet?
Laura, you may be excused if you're finished.
What happened to dancing school?
Nora received a very nice compliment from a teacher. She said she had professional potential. He didn't say potential. Potential is the future. Mr. Beckman is interested in Nora's immediate present.
Isn't that something? Mr. Beckman is your teacher?
No. He's one of the most widely known and respected producers on Broadway.
Broadway! Imagine that. That's wonderful. And how are you doing in school otherwise?
I'm doing fine. She's doing very well.
I wish I was as smart as she is.
Is that the same Mr. Beckman who's producing the Broadway extravaganza Abracadabra? I hear if a girl gets a job in the course of a show like that,
not only is a career practically guaranteed, but the experience she gains is equal to a 4-year college education.
No, Jane, that's enough.
Only a 4-year college education is equal to a 4-year college education.
I don't think Abraham Lincoln went to college.
What about you, Lori? You're feeling all right?
Yes, Jack.
You're getting plenty of fresh air?
As much as I can hold in my lungs. Nora, did you tell Uncle Jack about the big tank that's filled with water?
Girls, why don't we let Uncle Jack finish his dinner? If we have something to discuss, we can discuss it later.
Somebody has something to discuss? If there's a problem, this is the time to bring it up. This is the family hour.
What a great idea for a radio show.
The family hour. Every Wednesday night, you get a different family eating dinner discussing the problems. And you get to hear this different recipes.
WAF presents Dinner at Brighton Beach, starring the Jacob Jerome family, and featuring tonight's specialty,
liver and cabbage. Brought to you by X-Lax.
The whole country's gonna hear about a 15-year-old boy gagging on liver.
Nobody has any problems? Nothing to discuss? Otherwise, I want to turn on the news.
Well, as a matter of fact,
what?
Nothing.
I threw up with this.
You sit there and you finish your liver.
I can't swallow it. It won't go down.
Remember the lima bean catastrophe last month?
Does anybody want a repeat of that disgusting episode?
Why does he always talk like it's a Sherlock Holmes story?
He thinks he's a writer.
And what do you think you are?
Eight half of it.
Which half to go terrible?
One. Two bites.
One bite.
Not two bites.
I know you. If I eat one bite, you make me eat another. I'll take it to my room. I'll eat it tonight. I need time to chew it.
So not time to waste food. Then why, Eugene, you shouldn't have taken it.
I didn't take it. They gave it to me. It comes attached to the plate.
If it's so important to everybody, I'll eat your liver, Eugene.
You will?
It seems to be the only thing this family's worried about. Give your liver to be on with more important things in our lives.
Nora's right. Take the liver away. If nobody likes it, why do you make it?
Because we can't.
Suddenly felt vulgar and cheap.
Stanley, turn on the news.
Laurie, get off the seat. You look tired.
Can I talk to you a minute, Pop? It's something really important.
More important than what's going on in Europe?
Not more important. It's just coming up soon.
Hitler's already moving to Austria. In a couple of months, the whole world will be in it. What's the matter with this radio?
Someone's been fooling around with it. Haven't they, Eugene?
Why, Eugene? Pop was listening to the news
last night.
You weren't listening to the ball game this afternoon.
Yeah, he's talking about Poland. Damn it. I don't want anyone touching this radio anymore, do you understand?
Guess who's gonna get blamed for the war in Europe?
Eugene, bring him the knives and gloves.
Do you really think there'll be a war, Pop? I mean, in America, too.
We're already in it. Not us, maybe, but friends, relatives. If you're Jewish, you got a cousin suffering somewhere in the world.
Ida Kaczynski's family got out of Poland last month. The story she tells us about what's going on there, you don't even want to hear.
How many relatives do we have in Europe?
Enough. Uncles, cousins, your father has nephews, I have a great aunt.
I have a cousin, Sholem, lives in Poland, his whole family.
They have relatives in Warsaw, that's where his father was born.
What if they get to America? Where will they stay?
Who?
Your cousins and nephews, moms, aunts, and uncles. Where will we put them?
What are you worrying about things like that for? Don't you have a speech to go, right?
Well, what speech?
How are you going to ask Mr. Strawhorn for a rice cake?
Can I talk to you later, Pop? After you've rested and read your paper?
Lou Gehrig got 3 hits today. Lurupin Lou's hitting 302.
Is this your paper? How many times have I told you? You don't read it until your father's finished with it.
Didn't break, Keith. The print doesn't come off. I take a quick look at it.
Don't be fresh, dear mother. Upstairs.
Pop?
Everybody!
Come down later, okay, Pop?
Tomorrow, Stan, I have to talk to you anyways.
You're a pest. Did anyone ever tell you you're a pest?
Yeah, I have a list upstairs. You want to add your name to it?
Maybe you should lie down. There's nothing in that paper that's going to cheer you up.
What would we do, Kate? What would we do if they got off the boat and knocked on our door? How would we feed them?
The boat didn't feed me. I can't deal with boats that have a knife in them.
Uncle Jack, I know you're tired and you have a lot of things on your mind. But the rest of my life, me paying your decision. And I have to know tonight because I have to tell Mr. Beckman and let him know if I can go or not.
Who's Mr. Beckman?
Broadway producer we talked about at dinner.
Abracadabra, remember?
Laurie, upstairs this instant. Nora, not now, this isn't the time. It's never the time. You won't make a decision, and I don't have anyone else that I can talk to. Well, I'll make my own decision if no one else is interested. I'm 16 and a half years old, and I'll do what I want to do.
What is this all about?
Go on, doctor.
I'll take care of it. Nora's right, it's my decision.
What are you gonna tell her? That she can leave school. That she can throw her future away. Is that what you want to tell her?
What if I'm wrong? What if she's got talent? What am I supposed to say?
She can't talk to me. I'm her uncle, for God's sake. It's all the same family, isn't it?
She doesn't need an uncle tonight. What she needs is a father. Go on, she'll tell you.
I never learned.
Mind if I sit with you?
I wrap my life up in Dave so much. I never learned to be the mother.
If you want to talk, we'll talk. If not, not.
We have enough mothers here. This is a family. The world doesn't survive without families. Come on, make me some tea. You're the only one in this house who makes decent tea. Laurie, do your homework.
Listen, I know what it's like, Nora, not to be hard.
You do?
I grew up in a family of 4 children. My father, before he died, never could remember our names. My oldest brother was the big one. I was the little one. My brother Saul was the rotten one. Eddie was the skinny one.
Who am I?
The pretty one. What's the problem?
I don't know. It doesn't seem very important now.
I've never seen you cry over something that wasn't important. Look, I know I'm not your father. It's not my place to make decisions for you. But I can offer advice. Advice is free. If it doesn't fit, you can always return it.
Can we walk up the block?
Sure. We'll take a look at the ocean. My father always used to say, throw your problems out to sea and the answers will wash back up on shore.
Did they?
Not in Brighton Beach. Orange peels and watermelon pits washed up. That's why it's good to take someone who knows how to give advice.
Well, will you stop that? I'm trying to think.
I'm
glad I don't have your problems.
You're like an official American League baseball in the mouth.
I have to talk to you, Stan. Like a really serious, important talk.
Everybody in this house has to talk with someone. Take a number off the ball and wait your turn.
I had a dream last night. It was about this girl. I can't tell you her name, but she's gorgeous. We were really kissing hard, rubbing up against each other. There was this tremendous buildup, like at the end of the 39 steps. And then there was an explosion, like a dam broke, and everything rushed out to sea.
It was the greatest feeling I ever had in my life.
But when I woke up, I was all...
all wet.
Yeah, how'd you know?
It was a wet dream, you had a wet dream. I have them all the time.
You do? And there's nothing wrong if it happens to you?
Oh, you never had one before?
Yeah, but I slept through it.
You ever try to do it to yourself?
What do you mean?
Didn't you ever diddle with yourself?
No, never.
Baloney. I've heard you. You diddle 3-4 times a week.
You're crazy. What do you mean, diddle?
Whack off. Masturbate.
You'll be quiet. Laurie will hear you.
Oh, it's all right. It's fine. It's natural. Everybody does it.
You know guys who do it?
Every guy I know does it. Except that's the place from the fat kid. He does it to the other guys.
I can't believe I'm having this conversation.
You can't grow up without doing it. Your voice won't change.
Isn't it a medical book or something?
It's puberty.
It's what?
Puberty. You never heard that word before? You don't read books?
Yeah. The Citadel by A.J. Cronin.
We never mentioned puberty.
Even Pop did it.
Pop? Ah, Pop? You know what, Stanley? I think you're full of shit.
Oh. Hey! Don't let me hear you use that word again. Who do you think you are? You're just a kid. Never let me hear you use that word.
I don't get you. I mean, it's okay for you to say puberty, but I can't say shit.
Puberty's a scientific word. Shit is for those guys that hang around the beach.
Well, what do you expect me to say when you tell me that Pop whacks off?
But don't mean he still does it, because he's married now. But when he was 14, 15, the whole world whacks off.
President Roosevelt, too?
Rich kids are the worst. They whack off from morning till night. In college, all they do is sit around in their dorms drinking beer and whacking off.
Stanley, this is the most useful information you've ever taught me.
No. 5 times as much as boys.
5 times as much? Is that an actual figure?
Where do you get all this from?
Yeah, hear it. It's passed down from generation to generation. It's how our culture spreads.
5 times as much as boys. Sometimes they don't even say hello to you, and they're home all night whacking off.
Human, just like we are, they have the same needs and desires.
Why is it so hard to touch their boobs?
If you were a girl, would you like some guy jumping at you and grabbing your boobs?
If I had boobs, I would love to touch them. Wouldn't you?
Got my own problem. Thank you, fella.
Stanley, how do girls do it?
I can't explain it.
Please, Stanley, I will be your slave for a month.
Tell me, how do they do it?
Well, I'll need a pencil and paper. I'll do it later.
You want crayons? Maybe you should do it in color.
Look, Eugene, I've got a serious problem in my life. I don't have time to draw girls whacking off for ya.
I'll bet Nora doesn't do it.
Oh boy, could I win money from you. You think she's in the bathroom 7 times a day just taking showers?
She does it in the bathroom?
I knew 2 girls who used to do it during English class. I saw a girl doing it during a final exam. She got a 98 on a paper. She the one you were thinking about?
No, it was somebody else, so one of the beach girls.
Oh, it was Nora. I see what's going on here. I know why you dropped your napkin 12 times at dinner.
She drives me crazy. I think I'm in love with her.
Yeah? Well, forget it. She's your cousin.
What's wrong with being in love with your cousin?
It's against the laws of nature. If she was your stepsister, it would be... It would be dirty, but it'd be all right. You can't love your own cousin. Let me give you a piece of advice, Eugene. When you're going through puberty, don't start with anyone in your own house.
Who made up those rules? Franklin Roosevelt married his cousin.
Maybe he was a second or third cousin. But you can't marry your first cousin, and you end up with babies with... nine heads.
I wish Pop would get back. I have to talk to him.
I still would love to see her naked. Just once. There's nothing wrong with that, is there?
No, I do it all the time.
You've seen Nora naked?
Many times. I fixed the lock on the bathroom door and opened it pretending I didn't know anyone was in there.
I can't believe it. What a pig!
What did she look like?
All I can say is I was pretty miserable. She was my first cousin.
That was the night I discovered that lust and guilt were very closely related. I have to go wash up.
Have a good time.
I don't do that.
I'm sorry.
It'll be 6 years. Sometimes I forget his birthday, but the day he died, I'll never forget.
There wasn't another one like
him. Laurie asked me questions about him all the time. Was he funny, she asked me? What was the funniest thing he ever said? I couldn't remember. Isn't that awful, Kate?
Sometimes you talk like your life is off. You're still a young woman, you're still beautiful if you ever stop squinting so much.
I went with him for 2 years before we were married. What was I waiting for? That's 2 married years I didn't have with him.
Listen, Jack's company's having their annual affair in New York next Wednesday. At the Commodore Hotel, you should see how some of those women get dressed up. He wants you to come with us, Jack. Tell me to ask you.
Me? Who do I know in Jack's company?
You'll be with us. You'll meet people. Max Green will be at a table. He's the one whose wife came last year from. He's the number one salesman. He lives in a hotel on the Grand Concourse. He's a riot. You'll like him. Maybe you'll dance with him. What else are you going to do here every night, huh?
I don't have a dress to wear for a thing like that.
You'll make something. Jack will get you some material. He knows everybody in the garment district.
Thank you, Kate. I appreciate it. I can't go. Maybe next year.
Next year? Next year you won't have any eyes altogether. What are you afraid of, Blanche? Dave is dead, you're not. If God wanted the both of you, you'd be lying in the grave next week.
I have plans for next Wednesday night.
More important than this, they have this affair once a year.
I'm having dinner with someone.
You're having dinner? With a man? That's wonderful! Why don't you tell me?
With Mr. Murphy.
Who's Mr. Murphy? Oh, my God, I don't understand you. You're going to dinner with that man. Do you know where he'll take you? To a saloon, to a bar and grill. That's where he'll take you.
We're going to Chartov's, the Hungarian restaurant. You've never even met the man. Why do you dislike him so much?
I don't have to meet that kind. I just have to smell his breath when he opens the window. What do you think a man like that is looking for, huh? I grew up with that kind on Avenue Way. How many times have Stanley and Jean come home from school black and blue from the beatings they took from those Irish hooligans? What have you got to talk to with a man like that?
Is that why you don't like him? Because he's Irish? When have the Jews and the Irish ever fought a war? Don't you know who George Bernard Shaw is?
I don't care who he is.
One of the greatest Irish writers in the world? What would you say if he took me to Chartov next Wednesday?
Is Mr. Murphy a writer? Tell him to bring me some of his books. I'll be glad to read them.
Kate, when are you going to give up being the older sister?
I've heard stories about him. With women. They like their women. You know? Well, that's what you want. It's your business.
I decided to go downstairs and quiet my passion with oatmeal cookies.
We took a walk along the beach last Thursday. He hardly said a word. He's very shy, very quiet. He told me where his parents came from, an island. They didn't have it any easier than Mama and Papa in Russia.
Nobody had it like they had it in Russia.
He holds down a decent job at a printer's office, and he didn't smell of liquor, and he behaved like a perfect gentleman. No cookies for you, not until you finish that liver!
You're still saving me? You mean it's gonna be in the icebox until I grow up?
No cookies, you hear me?
I just want a glass of water.
You have water in your bathroom!
There's toothpaste in the glass. It makes me nauseous.
Listen, there's no point in discussing this. I'm going to bed. Do what you want.
Kate, I don't want to do anything to make you unhappy. What, Jack? I owe too much to you. I can't live off you for the rest of my life. But every decent job I've tried to get, they turn me down because of my eyes. The thought of marrying Frank Murphy hasn't even occurred to me. Maybe not even to him. But I don't think one dinner at Charbonne's is the end of the world.
I just don't want to see you get hurt. I never mean you harm. I can take anything except when somebody in the family's mad at me.
I can never be mad at you, Kate, but I promise you to my dying day.
Go on. Have dinner with Frank Murphy. If Pop ever heard me say those words, he'd get up from the cemetery and stand in front of our house with a big stick.
Two minutes. I'll tell it as fast as I can.
Go on, Kate. Go to bed. boy wants to tell me something.
Turn the lights out when you're through. Don't worry about things so much. We've always made them work out.
Nora saw me on the grapple! She saw me on the grapple!
I might as well be dead.
I've got a problem, Pop.
If you didn't, you wouldn't live in this house.
Must be tough being a father. Everybody coming to you with their problems. You have to have all the answers. I don't know if I could handle it.
Stop trying to win me over. Just tell me the problem.
I got fired today.
What?
Don't get excited. Don't get crazy. Let me just explain what happened.
What did you do? You came in late. You were fresh to somebody. Were you fresh to somebody?
I'm not bad yet. I can still get my job back. I just need you to help me make a decision.
Take it back. I don't care what it is. This is not the time for anybody in this family to be out of work. Do you hear me?
When I was 12 years old, you gave me a talk about principles, remember?
All night wanted to tell me this news.
This is about principles, Pop.
How long did it go without telling me?
You at least hear my principles.
All right. I'll hear your principles. But then, you'll hear mine.
Okay, just sit back and let me explain what happened, okay? Well, it was on account of Andrew, the colored guy who sweeps up.
So Stanley began his sad story. Pop never said a word. He just sat there and listened. Stanley was terrific. It was like that movie, Abe Lincoln in Illinois. Not only was he defending his principles, but he was defending democracy and the United States of America. Pop must have been bleary-eyed, because not only did he have to deal with Stanley's principles, Nora's career, the loss of his noisemaker business, how to get Aunt Blanche married off, and Laurie's fluttering heart. But at any moment, there could be a knock on the door, with 37 relatives from Poland looking for a place to live. Finally, Stanley finished his story.
So, either I come in tomorrow with a letter of apology, or I don't bother coming in at all. And I know it's late. I know you're tired. I just didn't want to do anything without asking you first.
Oh, Stanley, Stanley, Stanley.
I'm sorry, Pop.
You should not have swept the dirt in his shoes.
I know.
Especially in front of other people.
I know.
He's your boss. He pays your salary. His money helps put food on our dining table.
I know, Pop.
We don't have money to spare. Believe me when I tell you that.
I believe you, Pop.
You were sick 3 days last year. He nearly got to a day and a half's pay. You remember that?
Oh, I know. I can see what you're getting at. I'll write the letter. I'll do it tonight.
On the other hand, you did a courageous thing. You defended a fellow worker. No one else stood up for him, did they?
I was the only one.
That's something to be proud of. It was what you believed in, that's standing up for your principles.
That's why I didn't want to write the letter. I knew you'd understand.
The question is, can this family afford principles right now?
We'll make it hard, I know.
Not just on you and me, but on your mother, Aunt Blanche, Nora, Lori.
Eugene.
Eugene would have to get a part-time job. Time he should be using studying books to get himself somewhere.
He wants to be a writer. He wants to go to college.
I wish I could have sent you, Stan. I've always been sick about that.
No, I like working, Pop. I really do. Look, I've made up my mind. I'm gonna write the letter.
I'm not saying you should.
I know. It's my decision. I want to write the letter.
And how will your principals feel in the morning?
My principles feel better already. You told me you were proud of what I did, and that's all I really care about.
You know something, Stan? I don't think there's much in college they can teach you that you don't already know.
Guess who I learned it from? Thanks for talking to me, Pop. I'll see you in the morning. Are you coming to bed?
I think you'll sit here a while. It's the only time of the day I have a few minutes to myself.
How'd it go? Did you have to write the letter?
Yeah.
I knew that's what he made you do.
He didn't make me do it. Be quiet, I have to contemplate.
What are you gonna say?
I don't know. You wanna help me with it? You're good at these things.
You know, people used to get paid for that kind of thing. Professional letter writers?
Not paid in money.
Oh, I don't want money.
Well, what do you want?
Tell me what Nora looked like naked.
How horny can you get?
I don't know. What's the highest score?
Alright, after we finish the letter.
I don't trust you. I want to get paid first.
Oh, you're a real shit, you know that?
Don't talk like that in front of me, I'm just a kid.
All right, what do you want to know?
Everything. From the time you opened the door.
Well, it all happened so fast.
Okay, tell it slow.
Look, I heard the shower running. I heard it stop, then I gave it a few seconds for the water to run off her body. Then I knew she'd be stepping out of the shower. Then all of a sudden I opened the door, and there she was. Towel on her head and nothing else in the whole world.
Slower, don't go so fast.
Her breasts were gorgeous. Like two peaches on a vine, just waiting to be plucked. Oh no. Maybe like two nectarines, all soft and pink. Oh, and shining in the morning sun.
Murphy coming over to pick up Aunt Blanche.
She's angry at the whole world.
That's why she's making lima beans for dinner.
Would you like a cashew, Laurie?
Oh, thanks. And a Brazilian too. And one.
You must be starved. We're having dinner late tonight. We'll wait till your mother goes out.
Can I have some love, Mom?
Just one. It's for the company. We're eating in the kitchen tonight. We'll wait till your mother goes out. You and Stanley help with the dishes. You look all flushed. You don't have a fever, do you? Let me see your tongue. Oh, it's all spotted.
That's the cashew.
Don't on me too. If you're tired, I want you in bed.
I have a little stomach cramp. Maybe I'm getting my ladies.
Your what?
My ladies. The thing that Nora gets when she can't go in the water.
I don't think so, darling. Not at your range, but if your stomach hurts real bad, you come and tell me. I made a nice tuna fish salad tonight. Oh, and call me when your mother comes down.
Aunt Kate! Does Mom like Mr. Murphy?
I don't think she knows him very well yet, though.
Do you like him?
I never spoke to the man.
You call them a Cossack. Are those the kind of people that don't like Jewish people?
I'm sure Mr. Murphy likes your mother, otherwise he wouldn't be taking her out to dinner.
If Mom married Mr. Murphy, would we have to live in that dark house across the street with that creepy woman in the window?
We're not up to that yet. Let's just get through Chawdaw's restaurant first, okay?
Pop's feeling better. Through the newspaper, because they didn't bring in the evening edition.
Lock the door.
You look terrible. You were crying. Your eyes are all red.
I'm in trouble, you. I mean, real big trouble.
When did you take up smoking?
I'm smoking the stockroom all the time. But don't let me see you do it. It's a bad habit.
So how come you do it?
I like it.
What brand do you smoke?
Lucky Strikes.
I knew you would. That's the best brand.
Promise me what I tell you, you're never gonna tell another living soul.
I take an oath on the life of the entire New York Yankees. What happened?
I lost my salary.
What?
The entire $17, it's gone, I lost it.
Where? In the subway?
In a poker game, I lost it gambling.
In the poker game?
Will you shut up? You wanna kill Pop right in his bedroom?
You never told me you gambled.
We used to do it at lunch hour. Just for pennies, I always won. A dime, a quarter. It wasn't just luck, I was really good.
$17.
Look, when Pop was sick, I thought I could make some extra money to help out. So I went over to this game at the stock with my floor shine shoes. What did I learn about poker? They cleaned me up in 20 minutes.
What are you gonna tell them?
I don't know. If Pop wasn't sick, I'd tell him the truth. Last week, he's telling me how great I am. He's driving a cab at night. Not playing. I'm playing poker about floor shines.
Yeah, but suppose you won. Suppose you won $50. You just had bad luck, that's all.
I had no chance against these guys, Eugene. They were gamblers. They all wore all black, pointy shoes with clocks on their socks. Pop dies, I'll kill myself, I swear.
Don't talk like that. Pop isn't gonna die. He ate 3 lamb chops tonight. Why don't you just say you lost the money? You had a hole in your pocket. You can tear a hole in your pocket.
Well, I already used that one.
When?
When I lost $5 in November. He said to me, check your pockets every morning from now on.
What happened to the $5? You gambled that away too?
No. I gave it to a girl, you know, a pro.
A what? A prostitute? You went to one of those places? Holy shit!
Hey, don't let me warn you about that word again!
Is that how much it costs? $5?
$2.50, I want this guy I know. He still owes me.
And you never told me? What was she like? Was she pretty? How old was she?
Don't start with me, Eugene.
Did she get completely naked or what?
Well, every time I get in trouble, do I have to tell you what a naked girl looks like? Do me a favor, Eugene. Go in the bathroom, whack off, and grow up by yourself.
Don't get sore. If you and me ask the same questions.
Oh, yeah? Well, I never had an older brother when I was growing up. I had to do it all on my own. You don't know how lucky you are. You don't have the responsibilities I do. You're still in school, looking up girls dressed in the staircase.
I worked plenty hard in school.
Oh, yeah? Well, let me see your report card. It's the first of the month. I know you got it. I want to see your report card.
I don't have to show you my report card. You're not my father.
As long as Papa's sick, I am. I'm the only one working, ain't I?
Oh, yeah? Well, where's your salary this week? Huh?
I hate you sometimes. You're nothing but a lousy shit. I help you all the time, and you never help me without asking for something for it. I hate your disgusting guts.
Not as much as I hate yours. You snore at night, you pick your toenails, you stink up the bathroom, when I go in there, I have to puke. Well,
give me your report, goddammit. Give it to me, or I'll beat your face in.
Fine. You want my report card? Here. Here's my lousy report card. You fascist!
Well, A's and a B. That's good. It's real good, Eugene. And you're smart. I want you to go to college. I want you to be someone important someday. Because I'm not. Damn good. I'm sorry I said those things to you.
Me too. I'm sorry too.
Hi, Kadap. Are you feeling better?
A little, darling. Your mother's not down yet?
No.
I wanted to see her before she goes out.
Oh my God, are you crazy? Are you out of your mind? You're walking down the stairs?
I'm all right. I was tired of laying in that bed. I wanted to see Blanche.
How are you gonna get back upstairs? You think I'm gonna carry you? The doctor said you're not even supposed to go to the bathroom, didn't he?
You trust doctors? My grandmother never saw one in her life. She lived to be 87 years old.
She didn't have high blood pressure. She never fainted or was sober.
She used to faint 3-4 times a week. It's in her family. We're fainters. Laura, darling, go get your Uncle Jack a glass of ice water, please.
Now?
Yes, now, sweetheart.
That child is pampered too much. She better do more work around the house. You don't get healthy lying around on couches all day.
No. You get healthy driving cabs at night after you work 9 hours cutting raincoats. You want to kill yourself, Jack? You want to leave me to take care of this family alone? Is that what you want?
You figure I'll get better faster if you make me feel guilty? I was born with enough guilt, Katie. If I need more, I'll ask you.
I'm sorry. You know me, I'm not happy unless I can worry. My family will worry us. Warriors generally marry fainters.
I'm not gonna leave you. If I didn't leave you for another woman, I'm certainly not gonna drop dead.
What other woman? That bookkeeper, Helen?
Again with Helen? You're never gonna forget. I danced with her 2 years in a row at the Commodore Hotel.
Don't tell me she isn't attracted to you. I noticed that right off.
What does a woman like that want with a cutter? She likes the man up front, the salesman. She's a widow. She's looking to get married.
You're an attractive man, Jack. Women like you.
Me. Attractive. You really must think I'm dying, don't you?
You don't know women like I do. Just promise me one thing. If anything ever happened between you and that Helen, let me go to my grave without hearing you.
I see. Now that you're worried about Helen, you decided that you're gonna die first.
I had to talk, yes. I'm all out of breath.
It's good for you, darling. It's exercise.
I'm going out. I won't be having dinner. I'll be home late. I have my key. Good night.
Nora! Don't you want to see how your mother looks?
Oh, I'm sure she looks beautiful. She doesn't need me to tell her.
What about Mr. Murphy? I know your mother wanted you and Laurie to meet him.
I have somebody waiting for me. I can meet Mr. Murphy some other time.
I think it would be very nice if you waited, Nora. I think your mother would be very hurt if you didn't wait to say goodbye.
Oh, I'm sure that's very good advice, Uncle Jack. I know just how my mother feels. I'm not so sure she knows how I feel.
Nora? Jack.
What'll I do?
Leave it alone. It's between Nora and Blanche or something they have to work out.
Who is she going out with? Where does she go every night?
With Larry Clemmer. He borrows his father's car and takes it to the cemetery.
What's
loves to see Daddy.
What'll I tell him? I don't want to spoil this evening for him, too.
Jack? What are you doing down here?
We have company coming. Where else shall I be?
I looked in your room. I got scared to death.
Well, you don't look it. You look beautiful.
Oh, Blanche. Oh, my God, Blanche. It's stuffy. Like a movie star. Who's that movie star I like so much, Laurie?
Irene Dunne. Irene Dunne. I think she looks like
Rosalind
Russell. Or maybe Karen Longwood.
I think she looks like Blanche. Blanche is prettier than all of them.
I had such trouble with the makeup. I couldn't see my eyes to put on the mascara, so then I put on my glasses, and then I couldn't get the mascara on under my glasses.
Where are your glasses? Have you got your glasses?
They're in my purse. I thought I'd, you know, put them on in the restaurant to look at the menu. Well, make sure you do. I don't want you coming home telling me you don't know what he looks like. So good to see you up, Jack. So you're feeling better?
It was nothing. I needed a rest, that's all. Besides, I wanted to meet this Murphy fella. A stranger comes in, he likes to meet another man. Makes him feel comfortable.
Thank you, Jack. That's very thoughtful of you.
Yeah. Take this. Don't say no to me, Blanche. Just put them on, please.
Kate, your pearls, your good pearls.
What else are they gonna do? Sit in my drawer all year?
You know, pearls are like people.
They like to go out and be seen once in a while.
You were gonna wear them to the affair tonight. I'm so wrapped up in myself, I completely forgot you're missing the affair this year.
I can afford to miss it. I don't see Jack there the whole night anyway.
Let's see how they look.
I'm so nervous all the time.
Tell me I don't have a beautiful sister.
Now I feel good. Now I feel like I got my money's worth.
Definitely Karen Lambert. Laurie, go get Nora. I want to show them to Nora.
She's not here. She left.
What do you mean she left? Without saying goodbye?
She had to meet somebody. She wanted to wait for you.
She knew I wanted to see her. She could have come in my room.
She'll see you when you get home. You'll look just as good at 12 o'clock.
What did she say? Did she say anything?
You're going now. You're going to have a good time tonight.
She's making me pay for it, isn't she? She knows she can get me so easily. That's what I get for making decisions.
I feel like ice cream for dessert.
Laurie, you feel like ice cream for dessert?
Butter pecan?
Butter pecan for you, maple walnut for me. Go up and tell Eugene. I want him to go to the store.
I'll go. Now run, darling.
Let her run. If she gets tired, she'll tell you. Let's stop worrying about each other so much.
Eugene! Your father wants us to go to the store.
Tell him I'm sick. My stomach hurts.
You don't want any ice cream?
Ice cream? Wait a minute.
It's amazing how quickly you recover from misery when somebody offers you ice cream.
She's only 16, Blanche. At that age, they're still wrapped up in themselves.
How am I ever going to become a writer if I don't know how to suffer? Actually, I'd give up writing if I could see a naked girl all eating ice cream.
What time is it? 6:30. He'll be here any minute. Take your mind off Nora Blanche. Don't wear my pearls out for nothing.
Eugene, go over Hanson's. Get a half pint of butter pecan, a half pint of maple walnut, a half pint of chocolate for yourself. Kate, what do you want?
I'm in no mood for ice cream.
Get a vanilla, she'll eat it. And whatever Stanley likes.
I need money.
I just paid the doctor $15. Go up to Stanley, he got paid today. Ask him for his salary.
What?
Here's a dollar. Hurry back so Laura can meet Mr. Murphy. But don't run.
You know what I worry about at nights? That she'll run off. That I'll wake up one morning and she'll be gone. To Philadelphia, Boston, and God knows where.
Look how the woman's going out on a date. Is that what you're gonna talk about? He'll start drinking in 5 minutes.
What'll I do if he gets drunk?
He'll come right home. Do you have money? Do you have car fare?
No, I didn't take anything.
Okay, right here, I'll go get $5 from Stanley. Oh, I have something else to worry about.
I could use a cup of hot tea.
Sit there, I'll make it.
We'll both make it. Keep me company. You can hear the doorbell from the kitchen.
Stanley! Are you in there? Open the window. You never get any air in this room. I need $5 for Blanche.
Yes, I got paid today.
Okay, take out your money for the week. Let me have the envelope.
I don't have it.
You don't have the envelope?
I don't have the money.
What do you mean you don't have the money?
I don't have the money. It's gone. I can't get it back.
It's gone? Gone where?
It's gone. I can't get it back. There's nothing I can do about it. Just please don't ask any more questions.
What do you mean, don't ask any more questions? I want to know what happened to $17, Stanley.
You'll tell Pop. If I tell you, you're gonna tell Pop.
Why shouldn't I tell your father? Why, Stanley? I want to know what happened to the
money. I can't! You did! I was playing poker, all right? Happy? Satisfied now?
I'm not gonna deal with this right now. I have to get Aunt Blanche out of the house first. I have your father's help to worry about. You're gonna sit in this room, and you're gonna think of a story. You were wrong. Somebody stole the money. I don't care who, I don't care where. That's what you're gonna tell him. Because if you tell that man the truth, you'll kill him as sure as I'm sitting here. Tonight, after he goes to sleep, you'll meet me in the kitchen and we'll deal with this alone.
I'm sorry.
Dear Mrs. Morton, I send regrets for my son Frank. I tried to reach you earlier, then realized he had no phone. Frank will be unable to keep his dinner engagement with you this evening. Frank is in hospital as the result of an automobile accident, and although his injuries are not serious, the consequences are. As a devoted mother, I would end this letter here and forward my apologies. Despite all my son's faults, honesty and sincerity have never been his failings. He wanted me to tell you the truth. And while driving a friend's motor car, he was intoxicated and was the cause of the aforementioned accident. The truth would come out soon enough, but Frank has too much respect and fondness for you to have you hear from some other source.
As soon as Frank can get out of his difficulties here, we have decided to move to upstate New York, where there is a clinic that can help Frank, and where we have relatives with whom we can stay. Frank sends along with his regrets, his regards for a warm, intelligent, friendly, and most delightful neighbor across the way. Yours most respectfully, Mrs. Matthew Murphy.
What is it?
He's not coming. He's in the hospital.
It was a sad letter, all right, but it sure was well written. Maybe I should have been born in Ireland.
I knew it! I said it right from the beginning, didn't I?
Oh God, that poor woman.
Does that mean you're not going out for dinner?
Could have been you in that call with him. I warned you the first day about those people.
Stop calling them those people. They're not those people. She's a mother like you and me.
And what is he? Tell me what he is.
He's somebody in trouble. He's somebody that needs help. For God's sakes, Kate, you don't even know the man.
I know the man. I know what they're all like.
Who are you to talk? Are we any better? Are we something so special? We're all poor around here. The least we can do is be charitable.
Why? What have I got I can afford to give away? Am I the one who got you all dressed up for nothing? Am I the one who got your hopes up? Am I the one they're gonna lock up in a jail somewhere?
They're gonna put him in jail?
Don't talk to me about charity. Anybody else, but not me.
I never said you weren't charitable.
All I did was try to help you. All I ever did was try to help you.
I know that. Nobody cares for the family more than you do. But at least you can be sympathetic to somebody else in trouble.
Who should I care about? Who's out there watching over me? I did enough in my life for people. You know what I'm talking about.
No. I don't, Kate. Say what's on your mind. What people?
You. Celia. Papa, when he was sick, everybody. Don't you ask me for people. How many meetings did I take from Mama for things that you did? How many dresses did I go without so you could look like someone when you went out? I was the workhorse and you were the pretty one. You have no right to talk to me like that, no right.
This is all about Jack, isn't it? You're blaming me for what happened.
Why do you think the man is sick today? Why do you think a policeman had to carry him home at 2 o'clock in the morning? So your Laura could have dancing lessons? So Laurie could see a doctor every 3 weeks? Go on, worry about your friend across the street, not the ones who have to be dragged home to keep a roof over your head.
What is this? What's going on here?
Why didn't you ever tell me you felt that way?
I never had the time. I was too busy taking care of everybody.
What is it, Kate? What happened?
And it took all those years. It took something like that letter for you to finally get your feelings out.
I didn't need a letter. I just needed you to ask me.
Laurie, upstairs now. The conversation isn't for you.
The ice cream's ready.
Eugene, put the ice cream in the icebox. I have to talk to your mother.
I never spoke to the woman. I lived in that house for 3 years. I never exchanged a word with her.
If you're out of bed, at least sit in a chair, please.
If I could take the girls and pack them out of this house tonight, I would do it, but I can't. I have no place to take them.
Blanche, what are you talking about? Don't say such things.
If I can leave the girls with you for another few weeks, I'd appreciate it. Until I can find a place of my own, and then I'll send for them.
You're not sending for anyone, and you're not leaving for anywhere. I don't want to hear this kind of talk.
Let her do what she wants, Jack.
I have a friend in Manhattan Beach I can stay with for a few days until I can find a job. I will do anything anybody asks me, but I will never be a burden to anybody ever again.
Stop it, Blanche! Stop it right now! What the hell is going on here, for God's sake? Two sisters having a fight they should have had 25 years ago. You want to get it out, Blanche? Get it out! Tell her what it's like to live in a house that isn't yours. To have to depend on somebody else to put the food on your plate every night? I know what it's like, because I lived that way until I was 21 years old. Tell her, Kate, what it is to be an older sister. To suddenly be the one who has to work and shoulder the responsibilities and not be the one who gets the hugs and the infection when you are the only one there. You think you don't see it with Stanley and Eugene, with Nora and Laurie? You think I don't hear the fights that are going up in those rooms night after night? Go on, Kate, scream at her, yell at her. Call her names, Blanche. Tell her to go to hell for the first time in your life. And then when you got it out of your systems, give each other a hug and go have dinner. The lousy ice cream is melting, for God's sake.
I love you both very much. No matter what Kate says to me, I'll never stop loving him. But I have to get out. If I don't do it now, I'm worried I'll lose whatever self-respect I have left. For people like us, sometimes the only thing we really own is our dignity. And when I grow old, I'd like to have as much as Mrs. Matthew Murphy across the street.
What is it, Kate? What happened? Something terrible must have happened to you tonight to behave like this. It wasn't Blanche. It was something else. Or was it, Kate?
Tell the kids to come down in 5 minutes.
Where are you in the kitchen tonight?
Get Stanley and Laurie. It is in 5 minutes.
It was the first day in my life I didn't get blamed for what just happened. I felt real sorry for everybody. But as long as I wasn't to blame, I didn't feel all that bad about things. That's when I realized I had a selfish streak in me.
I sure hope I come out of it.
Blanche is leaving.
Where?
To stay with some woman in Manhattan Beach. She and Mom just had a big fight. She's gonna send Lenora and Lauren when she gets a job.
What did they fight about?
I couldn't hear it all. I think Mom sort of kind of blames Aunt Blanche for Pop having to work so hard.
Oh, God. Did she mention anything about me? About how I lost my salary?
You told her? Why would you tell her? I came up with 12 terrific lies for you.
How much money do you have?
Me? I don't have any money.
Well, the hell you don't? You have money in this gap box. How much do you have?
I got $1.12. It's my life savings.
Let me have it. I'll pay it back, I swear.
What are you putting all those on for?
I have to sleep out tonight. I'm leaving, Jean. I don't know for where, but I'll write to you when I get there.
You're leaving home?
When I'm gone, tell her what happened to my salary. And tell her, please, don't shoot me out at Mom, because it was my fault, not hers. Will you do that?
I've got 8 cents worth of stamps if you want that, too.
Thanks. Hey, what's this?
The medal you won 2 years ago at the 100-yard dash.
The police athletic league. Yeah, I remember this. I didn't know you still had this.
You gave it to me. You can have it back if you want it.
It's not worth anything.
It is to me.
Sure. Well, you keep it.
Thanks. Where will you go?
I've been thinking about joining the army. Pop says there'll be a war in a few years, and I've been thinking I could be a sergeant by the time it starts.
Maybe, if it lasts long enough, I could join too. Maybe we could get in the same outfit.
No. You don't join the army unless the army comes to you. You go to college, you hear me? Promise me you'll go to college.
I'll probably have to stay home and work. With you gone, we'll need the money.
Well, I'll send home my paycheck every month. I hear sergeant in the army makes real good dough.
What do you have to leave for?
Don't stop crying, they'll hear you.
They'll get over it! I was mad at you when I got over it!
But because of me, the whole family's breaking apart! You wanna see Nora end up like one of those cheap boardwalk girls?
I don't care! I'm not in love with Nora anymore!
Hell, you should care! She's your cousin! Don't turn out like me!
I don't see what's so bad about you!
Take care of yourself, Eugene. You ever write a story about me calling me Hank? Always liked the name Hank.
guess there comes a time in everybody's life when you say, this very moment is the end of my childhood. When Stanley walked through that door, I knew that moment had come for me. I was lonely.
I was scared. And I hated my mother and father for making them so unhappy. Even if they were right, I still hated them.
And I even hated Stanley a little for leaving me there to grow up all by myself.
Eugene, Laurie, time for dinner. I'm not waiting all night.
And I hated her for leaving Stanley's name out when she called us for dinner. I don't think parents realize how cruel they can be sometimes.
At dinner, I tried to break the news about Stanley, but I just couldn't get the words out.
I left the table without even having any ice cream. If it was suffering I was after, I was beginning to learn about it.
It's almost 10 o'clock. Where is Stanley so late?
Never mind, Stanley. You should have been in bed an hour ago.
I won't tell you what happened between you and that boy.
I'm tired, Jack. I've had enough to deal with for one day.
I want him to come to temple with me on Saturday. They stop going for 3 or 4 weeks. They forget their religion altogether.
The house became quieter than I'd ever heard it before. Aunt Blanche was in a room packing, Mom and Pop were in their bedroom,
and I had to talk to somebody else, I'd go crazy.
I didn't have much of a choice. Laurie, it's Eugene. Can I come in?
I'm reading. What do you want?
I just wanted to talk to you, that's all.
I didn't say yes, did I?
Well, I'm already in, so it's too late. What's your reading?
The Citadel.
I read it. It's terrific. I hear your mother's leaving in the morning.
We're going to, as soon as she finds a job.
I can't believe it.
I'm going to be the only one left around here.
You mean you and Stanley?
Stanley's gone. He's not coming back.
I think he went to join the army.
You mean he ran away?
No, only kids run away.
When he's Stanley's age, he just leaves.
He didn't say goodbye?
My parents don't even know about it. I'm gonna go tell them now.
I wonder if I'll have to go to a different school.
We'll have to make all new friends.
I don't care. I don't have many friends here anyway.
Because you never leave the house. You never go out.
I can't because of my condition.
You don't look sick to me. Do you feel sick?
No. But my mother tells me I am.
I don't trust parents anymore.
Why would she lie to me?
To keep you around? Once they figure out Stanley's gone, they're gonna handcuff me to my bed!
I wouldn't leave my mother anyway. Even when I'm older, even if I get married, I'll never leave my mother.
Yeah? Mr. Murphy never left his mother.
And he ended up going to jail.
None of this would have happened if my father was alive.
How did you feel when he died?
I can't remember. I cried a lot.
I sure would hate it if my father died, especially with Stanley gone. We'd probably have to move out of this house.
Well, then you and your mother can come and live with us.
So if we all end up living together, what's the point in breaking up now?
I don't know. I have to finish reading.
You don't get too far talking to Laurie. Sometimes I think the flutter in her heart is really in her brain.
I went into their bedroom and broke the news about Stanley.
The monumental news that their eldest son had run off.
Probably get killed in France fighting for his country.
My mother said, go to bed. He'll be home when it gets cold out. I couldn't believe it. Their own son.
It was then that I suspected that Stanley and I were adopted. They finally went to bed, and I decided to wait out on the back steps until it got cold. But Stanley never showed up.
I wanted to talk to you. Now it's late. I know it's late. You could have talked earlier if you didn't come home at 12 o'clock. How was your dinner?
I didn't go. and Murphy was in an accident.
I'm sorry. Is he all right?
He's got his problems like the rest of us. I was very hurt that you left without saying goodbye.
I was late. I had somebody waiting for me.
So was I. You knew it was important to me.
I'm not feeling very well.
You purposely left without seeing me. You've never done that before.
Can we talk about this in the morning?
I won't be here in the morning.
Then tomorrow night.
I'm moving out, Nora. I'm leaving in the morning.
What are you talking about?
Your Aunt Kate and I have a fight tonight. We said some terrible things to each other. Things that have balled up since we were children. I'm going to stay with my friend in Manhattan Beach until I can find a job, and then I'll send for you and Maury.
I can't believe it. You mean it's all right for you to leave us? But it is all right for me to leave you!
It was never you leaving me I was concerned about. It was your future I was worried about.
It was my future. Why couldn't I have something to say about it?
I don't know. Maybe I was wrong. I never made the decisions for the family. Your father did. Everyone's always took care of me. My mother, my father, my sisters, even you and Lori. I've been a very dependent person all my life.
Maybe that's all I'm asking for. To be independent.
You earn your independence. You don't take it at the expense of others. Would that job even be offered to you if someone in this family hadn't paid for those dancing lessons or put a roof over your head and clothes on your back? If anyone's gonna pay Uncle Jack back, it'll be me. Doing God knows what, I don't know. But one thing I know for sure, I'll steal before I let one of my daughters show that man what else of ingratitude and disrespect.
So I have to give up the one chance I may never get again. Is that it? Am I the one who has to pay for what you couldn't do with your own life?
What right do you have to judge me like that?
Judge you? I can't even talk to you. I don't exist to you. I have tried so hard to get close to you, but there was never any room. Whatever you had to give went to Daddy. And when he died, whatever was left came to you.
What, then, who are you going to say?
I have been jealous my whole life of Lori because she was lucky enough to be born sick. Never turn on a light in my room or read in bed because Lord always needed her precious sleep. I can never have a friend over on the weekends because Lord was always resting. I used to pray I'd get some terrible disease or get hit by a car so that I'd have a leg all twisted and crippled. And then once, maybe just once, I'd get to crawl next to you on a cold rainy night and talk to you. Hold you until I fell asleep in your arms. Just once.
My God, no. Is that what you think of me?
Is it any worse than what you think of me?
I'm not going to let you hurt me, Nora. I'm not going to let you tell me that I don't love you or that I haven't tried to give you as much as I gave for me. God knows I'm not perfect because enough angry people in this house have told me so tonight. But I'm not going to be a doormat to all the frustrations that you, or Ray Kate, or anybody else wants to lay at my feet. I did not create this universe. I did not decide who lives or who dies or who's rich or who's poor, who feels loved or who feels deprived. If you feel cheated that Lori gets more than you, then I feel cheated that I had a husband who died at 36. And if you keep on feeling that way, you'll end up with something much worse than loneliness, a helplessness, and that self-pity. Believe me. There's no leg that's twisted a bent that is more crippling than a human being who thrives on their own misfortunes. I'm sorry, Mother, that you feel in love, and I will do everything I can to change that except apologize for it.
I'm done apologizing. After a while, it becomes your life's work, and it doesn't bring any money into the house.
If it's taking your pain and Anki's anger to get me to start living again, then God will give me the strength to make it up to you. But I will not go back to being that frightened, helpless woman that I created. I've already buried someone I love. Now it's time to bury someone I hate.
Didn't ask you to hate yourself. Just ask you to love me.
I do, Nora. My God, why can't I make that clear to you?
I feel so terrible.
Why?
Because I think I hurt you. I still want that job with Mr. Beckman.
I know you do.
But I can't have it, can I?
How can I answer that?
voices downstairs. I didn't know who it was.
I'm sorry if we woke you. Go on up to bed, Nora. We'll talk again in the morning.
They've never been any trouble to me, those girls, never.
I'll try to take them on the weekends if I can. It's late. We can all use a good night's sleep.
Blanche, don't go. I feel badly enough for what I said. Don't make me feel any worse.
Everything you said to me tonight was true, Kate. I wish to God you'd said it years ago.
What would I do without you? Who else do I have to talk to all day? What friends do I have in this neighborhood? Even the Murphys across the street are leaving.
You and I never had any troubles before tonight, Kate. It's the girls I'm thinking of now. We have to be together, the three of us. It's what they want as much as I.
All right! I'm not saying it shouldn't happen. But you're not gonna find a job overnight. Apartments are expensive while you're looking. Why do you have to live with strangers in Manhattan Beach?
Louise isn't a stranger. She's a good friend.
To make good friends are strangers. But sisters are sisters.
I'm afraid of becoming too comfortable here. If I don't get home now, when will I ever do it?
Whenever you want. The door's open. I'll help you look. I can move with you into a new place. I'll find out what they're asking for the marketplace. It couldn't be expensive. She never claimed it.
How independent can I be if I live right across the street from you?
Far enough for you to close your own door. Close enough for me not to feel so lonely.
Even if I lived on the moon, I'd still be close to you.
Jack wouldn't let me go to bed until I promised to come up with some good news.
Suddenly so hungry.
Of course, you haven't had dinner. I'll fix you some scrambled eggs, come on.
I'll make them now. I'm an independent woman now.
With your eyes, you won't get the eggs in the pan.
So, Aunt Blanche decided to stay while she was looking for a job. Nora went back to school the next morning, gave me a big smile, and her legs looked as creamy white as ever. Laurie was told to take out the garbage, which quickly got a flutter in her heart, so I had to do it. Things were back to normal.
Eugene, go back to Green Pot Simon Flower.
How much a teaspoonful? Stanley didn't come home that night, and even though my mom didn't say anything, I knew she was plenty worried. She went and told Pop how Stanley lost the money playing poker, and from the sounds coming out of the bedroom, I figured Stanley should forget about the army and try for the Foreign Legion. And then, all of a sudden, the next night around dinner time, Stanley came back. I was never so happy to see anybody in my entire life.
Right, where's Mom and Pop?
Mom's in the kitchen cooking. Pop's upstairs with the prayer book.
They figured if God didn't bring you home, maybe your potato pancakes would.
What happened? Did he join up?
Well, I came pretty close. I passed the physical 1, 2, 3.
I knew you would.
They were giving me cigarettes, donuts, the whole sales pitch. I mean, they really wanted me.
I'll bet.
But then, just as I was about to sign my name, I stopped cold. I put down the pen. I said, I'm sorry, maybe some other time. And I walked out.
How come?
I couldn't do it to Pop. Right now, Pop needs me more than the army does. And I know Mom didn't mean it when she said that she'd never forgive me about the money. But if I walked out on the family now, maybe she never would.
Gee, I thought you'd be halfway to training camp by now.
But I'm real glad you're home.
Eugene, I need a pint of sweet cream and some more sugar.
Stanley's home.
Get a 2-pound bag. I want to bake a chocolate cake.
A 2-pound bag from Greenblatt's? I'll need identification.
You staying for dinner?
Well, I'm staying as long as you'll let me stay.
Why wouldn't I let you stay? This is your home. Your father's been very worried. I think you all need some sort of explanation.
Just about to do that.
sorry I didn't come home last night. I just didn't know what to tell you about the money. I know it doesn't help to say I'll never do it again, because I won't. I swear, never.
I got $3.
I went over to Dominic's bowling alley last night and set pins till midnight. And I can make another $6 on the weekend, so that makes $9. I'll get the $17 back, Pop, I promise. I'm not afraid of hard work. The one thing you taught me, hard work and principles. It's the code I'm gonna live by for the rest of my life. So, if you have anything you want to say to me, I'd be glad to listen.
Did you read the paper tonight, Stanley?
No, Pop.
There's going to be a war. A terrible war, Stanley.
I know.
The biggest war the world has ever seen. And it frightens me. We're still in over the last one yet, and already they're starting another one.
Well, we don't talk about it much in the store because of Mrs. Stroheim being German and all.
My brother Michael was killed in the last war, I've told you that.
You showed me his picture in uniform.
He was 19 years old. The day he left, he didn't look any older than Eugene. He was killed the second week he was overseas.
I know.
They didn't take me because I was 16 years old. Both parents were dead. I was living with my Aunt Rose and Uncle Maury. They had two sons in the Navy. Both of them wounded, both of them decorated.
Uncle Leon and Uncle Paul, right?
My brother would have been 45 years old this month. He was a handsome boy. Good athlete, good dancer, good everything. I idolized him. The way Eugene idolizes you.
No, he doesn't.
He does, believe me. I hear him outside talking to his friends. My brother this, my brother that. Brothers can talk to each other the way fathers and sons never can do. I never knew a thing about girls until my brother taught me. Isn't it like that with you and Eugene?
Well, yeah, I tell him a few things.
That's good. I'm glad you're so close. I missed all that when Michael went away. That's why I'm glad he didn't do anything foolish last night, Stanley. I was afraid maybe you'd run away. I hear you and Eugene talking sometimes about the army. That day will come soon enough, I'm afraid.
I did think about it. It was on my mind.
Don't you know, Stanley, there's nothing you could ever do that was so terrible I couldn't forgive you. I know why you gambled. I know how terrible you feel. It was foolish, you know it already. I've lost money gambling in my time, I know what it's like.
Oh, you did?
You're so surprised? You think your father's a perfect human being? Someday I'll tell you some other things I did that wasn't so perfect, not even your mother knows. If you grow up thinking I was perfect, you'll hate yourself for every mistake you make. Don't be so hard on yourself. What you got a mother and father to do?
Hey, you're not hard on me, you're always fair.
I try to be. You're a good son, Stanley, you don't even realize that. There are men in our cutting room who haven't spoken to their sons in 5-6 years. Boys who have no respect for anyone, including themselves, who have not worked a day in their lives, or who have brought their parents a single day's pleasure. Thank God I could never say that about you, Stan.
I lost $17 playing poker, and you're telling me how terrific I am.
Hey, don't get the wrong idea. If you were here last night when your mother told me, I would have thrown you and your clothes out the window. Today I'm calmer. Today I read the paper. Today I'm afraid for all of us.
I understand.
The night after dinner, you apologize to your mother and you give her the $3.
I will.
And apologize to Aunt Blanche because she was worried about you too.
I will.
And you can thank your brother as well. Last night he came into my bedroom and told me how terrible you felt. He was almost in tears himself. The way he pleaded the case, I thought I had Clarence Darrow in the room.
Oh, Eugene's a terrific kid.
All right, you'll get washed up and ready for dinner. And tonight, after dinner, you and I are going to go up in the backyard and I'm going to teach you how to play poker.
Terrific!
Is Eugene back yet?
Not yet.
You look tired. Did you get any sleep?
I got enough. I slept at a friend's house. Can I talk to you after dinner, Mom?
Where am I going? To our nightclub?
I'll wash up and be right down.
Stanley? You didn't join anything, did you?
No, Mom.
You've got time yet. This family's growing up fast enough.
Yes, Mom. It's all right. Everything is all right.
Who said it wasn't? Didn't I say he'd be home? Marbury, call your sister. Time to set the table.
I just broke the world record at Greenblatt's. Next year, I'm entering the grocery store Olympics.
Here's some mail for you, Pop.
Is that my sweet cream?
Never spilled a drop. The perfect run. Where's Stanley?
He's getting cleaned up.
Oh my God, I've got jury duty next week!
So, are you back in the family?
Yeah, everything's great.
Where is it? You wanna go for a walk on the boardwalk tonight and see what's doing?
Oh, I can't, I'm busy.
Doing what?
I got a poker game.
A poker game? Are you serious?
I'm playing poker after dinner.
I don't believe you.
I swear to God, I got a poker game.
You're crazy. You're genuinely crazy.
Stanley, if you lose, I'm not sticking up for you this time.
If you don't tell anyone, I'll give you a present.
What kind of a present?
Oh, well, are you gonna tell anyone?
Oh, what's my present?
Here. Don't leave it lying around. Open it slowly. Or slow them back. Close your eyes. And now look.
Oh my God! She's naked! You can see everything!
You be quiet! You wanna get caught with a thing like that?
Where did you get this from? Who is she?
She's French. All the girls are like that in Paris.
I can't believe I'm looking at this. You mean some girl actually posed for this? She just lay there and let some guy take a picture?
Laurie, Nora, time for dinner.
It's from the guy that owes me $250. He says I can keep it until he pays me back.
Don't take the money, let him keep it.
It's my appreciation for being such a good bud.
Anytime you need a favor, just let me know.
All right, now put it in a safe spot. It's time for dinner.
In a minute. I'll be down in a minute.
Kate! Where's Kate?
Don't run, you're always running.
It's a letter from London. My cousin Charles got out. They got her to Poland. They're free, Kate.
Thank God.
His wife, his mother, all four children. They're sailing from New York tomorrow, Della. They'll be here in a week.
Do they speak English?
I don't think so. A few words, maybe. They had the salary thing. They only took what they could carry.
Well, they stay.
We'll have to discuss it with the family here. Some with Uncle Leon, Uncle Paul.
With us. They'll stay with us. We'll put some beds in the dining room. It's easier to eat in the kitchen anyway.
The little ones can stay with Maury.
Nora, you can sleep in my room, can't you, dear?
Of course
I will. And don't worry about the money, Pop. I'm gonna hit Mr. Straw on for that race tomorrow.
They got out. That's all that's important. They got out.
Eugene, we're all waiting for you!
In a minute, though. I'll be down in a minute. I just have to write down something.
October the 2nd, 6:25 p.m.
A momentous moment in the life of I, Eugene Morris Jerome. I have seen the golden palace of the Himalayas. You
Assistant director or stage manager?
Come on!
Yeah,
come out.
They built this amazing set.